just let me know as people join. Yeah, no, there's no one here.
Yeah, no one.
Do we need to send her an invitation, or does she just show up?
She'll show up before it.
For those of you joining our live this evening with Laura St-Pierre, thank you for joining us. We see you popping up on the screen. We're just going to hold our image on this beautiful piece named Incubator while we wait for a few more people to join and for Laura to join us.
Hi, Cecile, Nancy. Thank you for everyone joining us. We send an invitation to Laura St-Pierre, and we're just waiting for her to come online. No, we don't have an opening tonight.
I know.
I'm doing a live with Laura. Oh, you're joining the live.
I didn't know if we should.
That's okay. You're welcome to.
Stick our head and just say hello. But you're going to interview her and do
yeah.
Tape that.
But it'll show. It'll just be on our screens. You won't hear her.
Yeah. Gotcha. We'll say.
I think I hear Laura.
Hello.
She's here. Hi, Laura.
Hi.
A couple of your friends just popped into the gallery. Catherine Uccello and Ron.
Hi.
She's giving a very exuberant hi. I have my AirPods on, Laura, so they can't hear.
Tell them I'm sending. Go give them a big hug. Tell them it's from me.
I don't know if they're accepting hugs.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Give them an air hug.
A hug for you or a hug
that's,
for Laura?
That's from Laura.
Okay. Right.
But it can double as one from me. Long, wonderful friends. And actually, Catherine curated an exhibition with Laura at my gallery, though. Yeah, for exposure. How many years ago was that? 2018? Anyway, thank you for the introduction. And this is now our second solo show. Yeah. Okay, and February 11th, 2 to 5, Laura will actually be here. Yeah. See ya. No trouble.
Crash the party. Okay, bye.
Okay, I'm locking the door.
Well, those are some lovely faces to see. Aww. I love Ron and Catherine so much.
And we're excited, Laura, that you're going to join us in the gallery in February. We decided to postpone Laura's presence in the gallery until then because the Exposure Photography Festival takes place in Calgary in the month of February. So while we're opening the exhibition tonight, we're doing a virtual opening with Laura in Saskatoon. And in February, you're going to come and be part of the space and see all of this IRL.
That's right. I'm looking forward to visiting.
Wonderful. So are we. So thank you, everyone, for joining us tonight. We're going to have not a long conversation, but a heartfelt, warm conversation with Laura about this show, which we're excited to open tonight, Epiphytes at Dusk. And this is our second solo show with Laura in the gallery and the first time in our new Inglewood space. The work looks fantastic, Laura.
Thank you.
I really can't wait for you to see it in person. I'm going to say a few words about Laura, and while I do that, I'm going to ask my gallery director, Hassam, to just do a little tour of the space so that everyone can get a sense for the exhibition. The first work he's showing you is actually an earlier piece from 2018, but I thought it was a really nice inclusion with these newer pieces. So that one is there, and we're going to talk about it a little bit more. But for those of you who don't know me, I'm Vivian Mayer, and I'm the founder owner of Vivian Art in Calgary, and very proud to show these photographs. And our artist, Laura St-Pierre, lives and works in Saskatoon. And for nearly two decades now, Laura has been exploring her relationship with the natural environment. And that's quite a love affair, Laura. That's longer than most marriages last.
That's true.
That's true. And I, you know, I've seen some of the early pieces, those beautiful flowers that you were doing in the glass objects, like beakers and vases. And that's sort of where my relationship with you started. You were doing pieces like that. And then it's just transformed from there. Laura did two bachelor's degrees, because one wasn't enough, one at the University of Alberta and one at UBC. And she also did a master's of fine art in Concordia, Montreal, and has quite a prestigious CV in terms of her showing experience across Canada, including twice being included in the Art Gallery of Alberta's biennial, both in 2013 and in 2020. There was a version of the biennial that was a collaboration with the Reme Modern in Saskatoon, and she was also included in that exhibition. Her works in the permanent collections of the Dunlop Gallery in Regina, the Saskatchewan Arts Board, the Alberta Foundation for the Arts, and the Art Gallery of Alberta. So that's a nice list of accolades, Laura.
Thank you.
Yeah. So, okay, there's just a couple more pieces Sam's going to show you. And then I wanted to start by talking a little bit about your relationship with photography, and that being your main medium, really. You do video work, sculptural installations, but this kind of is the main medium for you, isn't it?
It is, yeah. And my work definitely falls into the category of constructed photography. I'm not stumbling upon things and documenting it. I'm definitely creating my own world and then taking mm-hmm. photographs based on that. So I'm not the kind of person who believes that a photograph documents something real. I create a narrative. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I set a scene, so I bring in objects, I bring in materials, I set something up, I photograph it, usually at a specific time of day that's very carefully chosen. I light things a very specific way, I photograph it, and then I take everything down, and all that exists is the photograph.
So
that's all that's left of that sort of moment or installation.
You remove it all afterwards. Hang on one second. What's that, Hassan?
Someone says that the video is frozen.
Do you want to
if they are seeing it?
If the video is frozen on your screen, I've got full bars of Wi-Fi right here, so I wonder if it might be where you're sitting. But let's move to another spot and see if it's better. Can you maybe focus another piece to some and see if that improves the video for them. So we were looking at poolside garden, Laura.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's an example where, and like often, somebody says it's not frozen, so that's good.
Okay.
like poolside garden is a good example. That's a site where I ask to use permission, so often I don't, but that's actually an apartment building patio.
Mm-hmm.
So I did ask, I knew somebody who lived in the building. Hi, Aunt Judy, if you're listening. So Aunt Judy asked the building managers, and they gave me permission to use that for an evening. And so I had an assistant, and we just quickly set things up, shot, and then took things down. I will just choose a site that I see that's kind of in a nowhere land. Like a lot of the spaces I use are kind of junk, what I call junk spaces. They're not really spaces that anybody takes care of or really pays attention to.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll just, like, there's one in the show where it's like there's you can see, if you look really carefully, you can see a Costco
yes.
behind it.
I found the Costco, Laura.
Oh, good, good. That's an Easter egg for you.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's an Easter egg. So.
So, okay. So I love this piece and I wanted to include it from 2018 because in this exhibition we did together, which was called The Sewers, you were staging these gorgeous constructions, which are very theatrical. And I love how you use drama, you know, lighting to create drama in your pieces. It's an example of you creating a work where there's evidence of the human hand in these greenhouses, but yet there's not actually a person in the image. And that's kind of changed quite a bit, hasn't it?
So in that earlier work, there were gardens. And we didn't usually see evidence of the sower herself.
Mm-hmm.
And in the more recent work, the sower has become a lot more prominent. That's really intentional. So I think my thinking has shifted a little bit in thinking, I mean, we can see in poolside garden that Hassam is showing you right now, you know, there's these carefully enveloped little gardens, these plants are obviously somebody's protecting them from the environment. Why? We're not really sure. But there's someone or something is doing a really good job there. And I really, as you know, we've all been through a lot in the last few years. And I really think that we spent a lot of time at home in our yard and really thinking a lot about our relationship to the natural world and especially a reciprocal relationship to the natural world. You know, we know that we need the plants to produce oxygen and the mushrooms to, you know, keep the soil healthy and all the sea creatures to keep the water clean and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, what's our role? And so I think in some of the new work, the sower becomes more and more apparent as I, you know, myself, as I think through, you know, my work is a way for me to think through these things, right?
Yeah.
And so how am I, you know, what's our role in kind of giving back with what the earth gives to us? Mm-hmm. What are we doing, right? Like we're taking quite a bit. You know, we all know that.
Yes.
But what are the little gestures of care and nurturing and that we can sort of give back? And in making the work, you and I were talking earlier in the week about, you know, in making the work and all these little things that I was, these little things that I've been constructing and building and like little portable gardens that kind of attach to my body or that I'm pushing or, you know, that kind of stuff. A lot of it is really reminiscent of taking care of another human in a way. And so it's not that different than taking care of a small human.
Right.
Right? Like, it's like you're taking care of a plant much in the same way as you're taking care of a little person, right? If the environment's not hospitable to the environment's not hospitable to an infant, right? Like, you can't leave an infant alone for very long before bad things start to happen.
Yes.
And much in the same way, yeah, much in the same way that I imagine this world that the sower lives in, it's the same for plants. It's like they're not going to survive very long without her attention.
So Hassam spent some time on incubators, which you don't really see. I mean, there might be some slight evidence of the sower or the tender, but then he moved over to epiphytes, which is the piece with you carrying what looks like a significant tree on your back.
Yeah.
And so that's a perfect example of what you were just talking about. Like that's, oh, that's like an infant carrier, but that is one hell of a large infant.
Yeah, that's an orange tree actually. Yeah, and it was a lot heavier than I thought it would be. And it did remind me as I was shooting it, that piece, it's really heavy, and it reminded me of, you know, you have a little baby, you carry them around, and then they get a little bigger, but they still want to be carried around a lot. And they get bigger, and they still want to be carried around. And, or, you know, so it reminded me of those younger years where my child was younger, and I had a lot of spinal problems.
Oh, God, yeah.
Right? Because you're always carrying them on one hip or something. Yeah, or the car seat.
So I can't help but think, first of all, when you were talking about staging and creating a constructed scene for your photographs, I thought about Jeff Wall or Thomas DeMand or one of those photographers who work similarly to that, where it's not just about capturing a scene, it's about actually creating a scene and
right.
capturing it.
Yeah.
And then when you were talking about this piece, I couldn't help but think about Cindy Sherman, because you've quite purposely chosen yourself as the sewer.
Yeah.
And so you're having to use what, a tripod setup and construct this whole composition, but then remove yourself?
Yeah, I often use like a remote in order to capture the photos. And like sometimes I will have an assistant for safety because
right.
I don't want to get mugged for my camera equipment. Like I'm often in places that aren't like they're sparsely populated or they're maybe not the best place to have like an expensive digital SLR with you.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll have, but I don't hire somebody else as the photographer. So I'll set up this, like I'll make them stand somewhere. I'll set the, I'll frame everything. I'll wait till the light gets to be just right. Cause usually I'm shooting as the sun's going down. Nobody wants to get up at like 5 a.m. to shoot with me for some reason. I don't know. And then I will swap places where I'll go, you know, stand where my assistant has been standing, and then I'll use the remote to shoot, and then I'll go back, check. That's what's so great about digital is you can just go back and check and see like what, you know,
what do the
images look like, and you can zoom in and make sure everything's in focus, and then I'll just go back and shoot some more. So I shoot quite a few and then cull until I find the right image. Yeah. And
yeah.
There is a little bit of Photoshop sometimes as well. Like if there's an object that needs to be moved or an object that I decide I don't want in the shot after all, then I have absolutely no problems using Photoshop to take things out or add things in or whatever. I do it in a way where the fact that I've altered the photograph isn't the focus of the image.
Right.
I'm trying to create a narrative, so I don't want to distract from that narrative by raising the issue of, you know, altered photographs.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah. That's my process, pretty much.
The inclusion of yourself as the sewer and the tender, is that a very deliberate choice? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Oh yeah, that's 100% deliberate. There's just art history is it's so contentious once you start using someone else's body. There are so many questions that come up. Especially the history of the female body in through the history of art, the male gaze, how that's all been problematic through the history of art, and when you start using someone else, it really, really changes things.
Yeah.
So for me, the least problematic approach is to use my own body.
Yeah.
where I don't do anything I'm not comfortable with, then, and there's no negotiation of having to ask somebody else to do things that they may or may not be comfortable with, to wear something that they're not may or may not be comfortable wearing, to take on a role, you know, because for me this is very much a fictional character that I'm embodying, so I don't have to explain.
Yes. Yeah.
But for the most part, it's really just a question of, you know, using the self as a way of circumventing those questions of the female body becoming an object.
Mm-hmm.
I'm really the subject here. Like, I'm taking the photograph, I'm pressing the shutter, you know, I'm doing it all by myself.
Yeah.
So I'm never the object, I'm always the subject.
And Hassam has been spending some time with mutualism and respire and heat and light and diffusion, which are really great pieces to look at in relation to what you were just talking about. And I, you know, you and I talked about scale for these, because of course with photography, we get to choose how big we print them, right?
Yeah.
And I can't tell you how happy I am with the scale of these pieces being a little more intimate, because they really feel personal to me. You, as the tender of these life forms, there's something really vulnerable and precious about it that I really like at this scale. And especially, I'm forgetting the name of the one I want to comment on, especially Heat and Light, which is the only one where you really actually fill the whole image.
Yeah. Yeah. And even in that one, like, it was really important to me that it not be about my body, but about the relationship between the plants and my body. And so the lighting there was really important. And I had to take a lot of shots, and like, that looks like an easy shot, but it actually took quite a few days actually to get that to the where I was happy with the lighting.
Mm-hmm.
On that and the posture.
Yeah.
Because again, I was shooting it and in it at the same time, so
yeah.
But I'm happy to hear that you say that about the scale and the intimacy, because that's exactly what I was going for. You know, and in those moments where we find ourselves more connected to the natural world, I think that's a level of, or a kind of intimacy that we're not really privileged to experience very
mm-hmm.
often.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very quiet kind of special. I don't know, maybe I wish I could think of another word besides special, but it's a very quiet, contemplative sort of thing that we, you know, in our current crazy Instagram, no offense, Instagram lies that we don't experience enough, and it can be very, it can be something that's very enriching.
Yes, and you've alluded to the fact that we have some responsibility, or you feel some responsibility to tend and to return to the land what we extract from it. And in these pieces, you really are reversing that role. Can you talk about that a little bit? Maybe in particular with, is this one diffusion? Is that?
Yeah, that one's diffusion. Well, I guess I just tried in this work to make it that relationship that, you know, we have this reciprocal relationship, and it's very implicit in our lives, right? We don't have to think about it. I mean, we still have a lot in Canada, right? We still have a lot of fresh water. We still have most of us do. Not all of us do. Most of us have a lot of fresh water. Most of us have a lot of fresh air. You know, we take all these things very much for granted. And so in this work, I was really just trying to imagine this world where that you can't take that for granted. And so in these works, I was really trying to imagine a place where the sower has to really pay attention to the reciprocal nature of that relationship, and so she has to, like, she's in the one where she's laying down with the plants, I'm imagining she has to keep them warm to keep them alive. Maybe
Right.
there's not enough
Yes.
heat where she is, right? And in diffusion, where maybe she's providing them with humidity
Oh,
or some kind
so
of moisture.
I can't help but just be curious. Are you drinking out of something or are you putting something in? It's hard to tell.
Yeah, I mean, could be either or, right? Could be either or. There's a water source there that is on that cart with the plants. And so, is she taking from it or is she adding to it? I don't it I'm kind of okay with that being a little unclear.
Right. Yeah, I kind
Yeah.
of like that too. Okay,
Yeah.
let's move over to mutualism and respire from that point. And I want to talk about this suit. Because I mean, just like you were talking about how you create a set and you create the image for the photograph ahead of time. You've added to that with the actual costume that you're wearing.
Yeah.
And in this one, you've actually got like some kind of a respiratory mask on your face,
Yeah.
that I assume you're actually feeding air into the plant, which is
Yeah. Yeah, I mean that could be either or, right? That I could be breathing air into the plants or the plants I could be extracting oxygen also from the plants in that image. Or the sower could. The plants are in a portable garden, so they're on wheels. That's like a one of those things that you go jogging with your babies in. So it's been transformed into some kind of portable terrarium or greenhouse. And I wanted it to be a little unclear as to whether the sower is getting oxygen or providing maybe CO2 or something to the plants, and so she's having to move these plants maybe from one location to another, or maybe she's taking this as a way to provide herself with some clean air while she's moving from one location to another, and again, that's that reciprocal relationship of we don't they can't sur maybe they can't survive without each other on that journey that they're going on.
And as much as this environmental crisis is perhaps a part of our reality and not science fiction anymore, right?
Yeah.
I can't help but think that there's a nod to science fiction in these imagery, just
Oh, for sure.
because of the outfit you're wearing and the masks and like in this image where the plants are actually like a mask.
Yeah.
I
Yeah.
start thinking about movie references and I get this sense of danger or of something being critical because of the physicality of what you're wearing and the apparatuses you've created.
Well, and so like the suit was, I wanted it to be something protective, but nothing that already existed seemed to feel right. Like it was like it had already too many, everything that already exists, like protective, gear or whatever that already exists out there already seemed too laden with its own references. So I had my friend sew something for me out of flesh-colored swimwear, and that thing, has been, has lasted for several years. It's indestructible. So I imagine that that's some kind of protective layer for the sower. And then, like the mask with the plants in it, that just developed out of reading about, early the Black Plague and early plagues where people would, had the cone masks and they would stuff them full of herbs and different formulations to try to filter out the germs, which they didn't really understand about
Yes.
what was going on, right?
Yes. Yep.
The mask in mutualisms is actually from, I was doing some research on survivalist culture, and that's actually made out of a 2-liter pop bottle.
Ah.
So you can find instructions online, just FYI everyone, if you're in a jam and you want to make your own mask out of a 2-liter pop bottle, it's actually not that hard. And it fits actually really well. You just need a little bit of elastic at the back to make it kind of
To make it hold
suck to
on.
your face. Yeah.
Yeah.
And a little bit of tubing at the bottom, wherever you're, whatever you're hooking into. So they do have a science fiction reference, but they also have a reference to things like historical things or things that people are actually doing or, you know, researching or thinking about.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm just going to address the audience for a second to mention that we're just about at half an hour. So we're going to talk a little bit longer, but I really do encourage if anyone has any questions that they'd like to pose to Laura, to go ahead and type those in. And we're keeping our eyes out for that, okay? I really enjoy this suit, and I really love the drama you're creating in these images, Laura. And for those that didn't catch it, there's the Costco.
I mean, in an apocalypse, I mean, if this is an apocalypse, I would definitely want to have access to a Costco.
I guess so. I mean, I feel like I'm in an apocalypse when I'm in a Costco. So it's like its own little kind of hell for me. But I mean, if you need stuff, it's a good place to go if you need stuff.
You would never run out of toilet paper, ever.
No. I'm going to wander
You'd
back
be good.
To, I'm going to wander back to Incubator, in part because physically, visually, I see a real connection between Incubator and those early works I referenced because of the dark black on this paper and the dramatic lighting.
Yeah.
So can we circle back and talk about Incubator and a little bit about your influences or intentions when you create a scene like this?
Well, I mean, it's really about the transformation, the transformative power of light, right? So, you know, the chiaroscuro, if we go back through like Renaissance painting and all that, has always been really important to me, an important influence. But, you know, I remember I did an installation at a gallery once. They invited me to do a huge photograph for the billboard. And so I did an installation. You know, a local restaurant let me use the space behind their restaurant, and I did an installation, and the gallery director was like, during the opening, we're all going to head down there, we're going to go check out the installation. And I was like, it just looks like a pile of junk. Like, it doesn't look like, you know, it doesn't, like, without the lighting and the point of view of the camera and everything, it's not transformed in the same way. Mm-hmm. She's like, I don't believe you. So she put on her winter boots and she trekked down there, and yeah, and then she came back. She's like, oh, you're totally right. It does just look like a pile of junk.
Yeah.
So, you know, there is that, like, it is, there's a relationship to installation. There's a relationship to sculpture, but that translation to the two dimensional is important. And the use of light is essential. It's not, you know, there's a reason that I either get up really early or stay up really late to shoot at a very specific time.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, spend a lot of time manipulating in, you know, in Photoshop to get exactly the right exposure, et cetera, et cetera. I print on a very specific paper called Hanya Mule Photo Rag, mm-hmm. which takes the ink in a very specific way so that I get these really rich black mm-hmm. that it's really hard to get on like a glossy or even a semi luster paper. So all those things are, you know, are like very intentional, I guess, to create that very specific look. And you know, that's, for me, that those aesthetic considerations are not incidental. They're mm-hmm. really important into drawing the person in. And the longer you can get someone to stand in front of your work, the more they think
yes.
about what you're showing them. So,
yes. Yes.
Yeah.
This is such a striking image, and I dressed to match it.
Right on.
I'm not allowed to pick favorites, though. I'm not going to pick a favorite, but I really like this one. Good work, Laura.
Thanks.
It's so striking. And, I mean, a lot of work goes into all of these constructions. For example, this one. This one's called the Ark, right?
Yeah, that one's Arc. Yeah.
And was this treehouse already there, and then you just went in and made it a greenhouse?
It was. It was my mom who pointed that treehouse out to me, and I think she's watching. So hi, Mom. Thanks. And she was my assistant on that shoot, and she helped me set it up and everything. So she's a pretty awesome assistant, actually. And yeah, but when I saw it, I thought, oh my gosh, that work is called Arc. And I thought, like, if you know, imagine that as an arc for plants. And you know, it was perfect. It was like almost a ready-made piece. So, and someone has just made the comment here that they like the scale of the works, however they feel, sorry, I think, oh, it's Violet Costello. I do like the scale of the works, however I feel they would also be very powerful wall size. When zooming in, I start thinking about the work existing within an augmented reality. I want to walk in.
Yeah.
And Violet, that's a great comment, and I have printed some of these at wall scale.
Yeah.
So I'm also not ashamed to say that works change size depending on their context. Mm-hmm. And so some works, like I recently had an exhibition at the college art galleries in Saskatoon, and there was a huge projection that was a still photograph, but it was projected, and it took three projectors to get it up to the scale. I think it was 30 feet wide or something like that.
Yes.
Yeah, I've printed, Vivian mentioned the Art Gallery of Alberta's biennial. I think there was a 24-foot wide by 8.5-foot mural in one of the biennials. Well, and actually both of the biennials, I had huge works. So in those kinds of spaces and in those kinds of exhibitions, I think those works are, those types of photographs are very appropriate, and they you know, and I definitely love having those opportunities, but I can't print at that scale every time. I love it because you confront it, you feel like you can walk into that space. It's a very haptic feeling, like you feel it in your body, you feel like you're there.
Yes.
But there's also something to be said for a much smaller work on a different scale, and you know, that you can just stand in front of it and lose yourself in it in a different way.
Yeah.
So I think for me, it's actually been a bit of a challenge. It's kind of funny because I'm like 5 feet tall.
Yeah.
So it's been a bit of a challenge to learn how to work smaller. I actually started, when I started in photo, I started printing quite large. Like I would say I've always been a large format, like from a printing perspective, not a shooting perspective. I've always been a large format person. And working smaller has always been a challenge. And I feel like I'm finally hitting my stride with that. So yeah, that was a good question.
Thank you,
comment.
Violet. Yeah, thank you, Violet, for that. And I agree with Violet with what she's saying, and with what you just expressed as well. This is a conversation that Laura and I have had because it is a commercial gallery space. So part of my focus is also to find a way to get this imagery into homes and into environments where people will actually get to see them. And not everyone has the ability to house a piece of art that is massive, right? So there's also a practicality sometimes that comes into it, but I think we made very good choices, I have to say, Laura, about what scale to print different pieces at in this context. I'm really happy with it. I hope you
are. Well, I don't think every image can be printed at 24 or 30 feet wide either.
Yeah.
I don't think every image can. Yeah.
Yeah.
So
we had a massive piece in our last show.
Mm-hmm.
I can't remember what the scale of it was, but it was,
I think it's about 16 feet or something. Yeah.
I think so.
Yeah.
It was big. 112 inches. So Sam remembers.
Okay. So it wasn't 16. It was more like 10.
112
yeah.
inches. He looked, he just knows because he was looking at the images from the old price list.
Right.
Does anyone else have any additional questions for Laura? It doesn't look like anyone does. I'm wondering if there's anything else, Laura, that you want to touch on that I haven't maybe asked about.
I don't think so, Vivian. I mean, I think we've covered it all. I think, or covered quite a bit anyway.
We didn't.
I'm not sure.
We didn't toast you. Okay, it's soda water in a champagne flute, but it's still a champagne flute.
I have peppermint tea in a mug.
So here's to you. I'm glad
Thank you.
That we're now at the point where you do get to come here and we do get to do this in person
mm-hmm.
and actually mm-hmm. have a cheers in person. So I'm really looking forward to having you here February 11th. For those of you who are around Calgary, that's going to be from 2 to 5. And probably around 2:30 or so, Laura will do an artist tour conversation of the exhibition. And the rest of the time, we'll have some wine here and we'll just visit and we'll treat it like an opening event, even though it'll be near at that point to the end of the exhibition. But this has been really nice tonight, Laura. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for your thoughtful questions. And Calgary people, I really hope to see you on the 10th. That will be wonderful.
And this is going to be a part of the Exposure Photography Festival, which is in the month of February. So I hope some of those folks will be here as well. And for those of you who are curious about these pieces, we do have an online store on our website, and these pieces are all there. And Hassam and I are, of course, here and looking forward to having visitors into the space to see the show. And more than happy to answer questions by email if anyone has any questions that are prompted from the conversation, or give us a call. This has been just a delight, Laura. Really nice to talk to you. And I can't wait to see you. It's only like a month away.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
Thanks, everyone, for coming. I can see all the names scrolling through here. We've had quite a crowd, so
it's absolutely
it's been really great.
Very heartwarming. And I hope to see a bunch of you in the flash soon. IRL, as they say. Ciao.
All right. Bye, everyone.